Praise the Lord. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Bible study. We bless your name because of your faithfulness. Thank you because of your spirit that you have sent to enlighten us, to guide us, to remind us of the truth of your word. We pray, Lord, not only at the Bible study, but outside at the crossroads, in times of challenges, in times of trial, in times of temptation, the Spirit of God will guide us to the truth that will grant us the victory in Jesus' name. We're asking, Lord, tonight, as we study your word, we pray that every word that comes from you, you will register on every heart, right on the tables of our hearts. Make it indelible, that when the time comes to apply the word, we will not forget in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Tonight we're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And we're looking at verses 1 through to 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, reading from verse 1. In verse 1 it says, "Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud, and all passed through the sea." And then in verse 5, it tells us in verse 5, "But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness." In verse 6, it says, "Now these things were for our example, to the intent, for the purpose, for the reason, that we should not lust after evil things, as they also lusted." Verse 11. In verse 11, it says, "Now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come." As we look at the verses before us tonight, we are brought back to the history and the story of the children of Israel, about their salvation, about their redemption, about their deliverance, and about the experiences they had in the Lord. And we're assured that the same Christ that saved us is that same Christ that saved them, that delivered them, that ransomed them, and that made them come out of bondage into the land of liberty. And they were told that the story of their lives, the experiences they had, actually are examples unto us, that we on our way to heaven, as they were on their way to Canaan, we learn from everything that happened unto them. That's why tonight the message is, believers, watchfulness on the way to heaven. Believers, watchfulness on the way to heaven. Taking that from the warnings for the children of Israel and their watchfulness and the required faithfulness they ought to have as they came out of Egypt and went through the wilderness on their way to the land of promise, on their way to Canaan land, on their way to that land that flows with milk and honey. And it says, all these things happened unto them for our admonition, for our instruction, and for our learning, so that as we are on our way to heaven, we who are living in these last days, that we will take lessons and take instruction and take counsel and take admonition from what happened unto them. Believers, watchfulness on the way to heaven. Let's come back to verse 1. In verse 1 it says, moreover, brethren, that word moreover connects us with the previous chapter. You remember Paul the apostle, by the Spirit of God said, we're running in a race. We're running in a race to get to the destination. And that destination is heaven. And he said, I keep my body under control, under subjection. And he said, I bring everything to subjection so that after preaching to others, after describing to others, after telling other people how they will get to the land of Canaan, he himself will not miss out and he will not be a castaway. That's why now, in connection with chapter 10, it says, moreover, brethren, talking to believers on the same race to heaven, talking to believers who are pilgrims on their way to the promised land, talking to believers, children of God, who have repented, who have been saved, and who are now members of the family of God, it says, I will not have you to be ignorant. Why did he say that? He said that because some of them were surprised that he said, after preaching to others, he could be a castaway. And some of them thought, no, you cannot. You saw the Lord Jesus on the way to Damascus. You were converted. You became Brother Saul. And not only that, you have had the calling. You have become an apostle. How can you be a castaway? And they were surprised, he said, this man who had been to the third heaven and who had heard music as well as things that he could not utter unto them. They were surprised, he would say, a saved man, a sanctified man, a spirit-filled man, a great apostle, an author, a writer of many epistles, could still say that he could be a castaway, except he will put under his body and put his life in check and in control and live by the word of God. That's why he said, don't be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and yet not all of them got to the land of Canaan. Not all of them got to the promised land. And he said, let's learn from that. We're dividing the message today to three parts. Number one, the past and present spiritual experiences through Christ. All the experiences of the past of the children of Israel compared with our own present experiences. Are we saved? So were they. Are we sanctified? So were some of them. Are we filled with the Holy Ghost? So were some of them, anointed and filled with the Holy Ghost. Are we conquerors right now by the name of the Lord? So were some of them. And so we want to look at the past experiences compared with the present experiences that we have through that Christ, the rock that followed them. Point number two, preventable yet permanent self exclusion through corruption. Preventable self-exclusion, yet unfortunately for many of them, permanent self-exclusion through corruption. All the people, all the children of Israel were regarded as the people of God. All of them were saved. They were brought out of bondage. And Moses said unto Pharaoh, let my people go, all the people of Israel. And then they were reminded as they went through Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, that he brought you, he redeemed you out of the house of bondage. Yet, some of them did not get to the land of Canaan. They excluded themselves. God included them. The lamb was given for them. The blood was shed for them. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. And yet, some of them could not get over there. That's why the Lord is writing the word and giving us the word. And he's saying, as it happened to them, we need to watch and we need to be prayerful so that we don't fall after the same example of those unbelieving people after they had first believed. Point number three, proper and personal self-examination without conceit, without deception, without dissimulation, without cajoling ourselves, without deceiving ourselves, proper and personal self-examination, so that whatever we need to put right, whatever we need to set right, everything is well put right, set right. And then whenever the Lord will come for the church, the righteous, the pure, the holy church will be part of the people that will make it on that final day, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, point number one is past and present spiritual experiences through Christ. Let's read now from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, reading from verse 1. Moreover, brethren, children of God, those who are born again, he was talking to the Corinthians who had known the experience of that first work of grace. Brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud. I want to remind you that the Corinthians were Gentiles like we are Gentiles. But then, whether circumcised or not circumcised, all of us now in Christ were one family. And therefore it says, brethren, and it refers to Abraham as our father, a father in the faith, and we are of the seed of Abraham, and all those Israelites as the fathers that came out of the land of Egypt, is referring to them as our fathers, that they were all under the cloud and all of them passed through the sea. You remember their story as they came out, the pillar of cloud, the pillar of fire was there to give them light in the night and shade and protection during the day. And then they pass through the Red Sea. That's what is referring to. And then in verse 2 it says, and they were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. It's now referring to the very fact that they passed through the sea, the Red Sea, and it says that ties with our own baptism in water. And they were baptized in the cloud. It's referring to the similarity between what they went through and our baptism in the Holy Ghost. Look at verse 3. In verse 3 it says, and they did all eat the same spiritual meat. When it says spiritual meat, that's the manna that came from heaven. That's the manna that came from the supernatural. That's the manna that came for the Spirit of God. He refers to that as the spiritual meat. And then he says in verse 4, he says, and they did all drink the same spiritual drink. That's the water out of the rock. For they drank of that spiritual rock. That is, it's not just the physical rock, it's symbolic and it's standing for the Lord Jesus Christ, the rock of ages. They all drank out of that spiritual rock that followed them. That is, the first time the rock was there and the rock granted them rivers of water. And then when they got to the next place again, it's like the rock there again, they could drink out of that. The rock that followed them, and now it says, and that rock was Christ. That rock was Christ. Well, he's telling us that those children of Israel, they had spiritual experiences. They were redeemed. They were saved. They were delivered. They were sanctified. They were made holy. They were made the peculiar people of God. They had the favor of God upon them. They had the experience of answered prayer. And he says, whatever we have now through Christ, they had similar blessings for them. Let's look at a few verses. Deuteronomy chapter 6, we're reading from verse 23. Deuteronomy chapter 6, reading from verse 23. It says, and he brought us out from thence, that he might bring us in to give us the land which he swore unto our fathers. Do you notice those words? He brought us out, and then that he might bring us in. Recently you heard the message, come out, come in, and conquer. He brought us out of sin, out of bondage, out of oppression, out of the iron furnace. He brought us out by grace, not because of the work of their hand, but by the grace of God. And then he intends to bring us in. He wants to bring us in into the abundance, into blessing, into joy, into happiness, into the land that is filled with milk and honey. He brought us out of darkness that he might bring us into the light. He brought us out of captivity that he might bring us unto freedom and liberty. That's what he did for them. And it is similar to what he has done for us. And Paul the Apostle, by the Spirit of God, reminded the people of Corinth, and is reminding the whole church, and he's saying, don't be ignorant of the fact that they had spiritual experiences. They came out that they might come in. The same thing that has happened to you. And then he said, but for you to get there, and for you to make it eventually, there are still things to look at on the way as you are moving on. Look at verse 24 there. In verse 24 it says, and the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes. It's not that, well, after we have come out of Egypt, then we're free to do as we want. We're free to live as we want to live. He has given commandments. He has given his word. And he has said we should do all these things to fear the Lord our God, to reverence our God, and to reverence our Lord, and to respect him, and to be obedient to him for our good always. He gave us commandments. He gave us instruction. He gave us directives, and he says, now that I brought you out of captivity, brought you out of bondage, and I brought you into blessing, you are to be obedient to the word of the Lord, that he might preserve us alive. The reason why he gave us the commandment, and the reason he wants us to be obedient to him, is that he will preserve us alive as it is at this day. Look at verse 25. In verse 25, it says, and it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before the Lord our God as he has commanded us. That's the experience they had. They were saved. And they, as children of God, were now commanded to observe the word of God as they went along. Exodus chapter 19, we're reading from verse 4. In Exodus chapter 19, reading from verse 4, ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, how I bear you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. I took you away from darkness, the darkness of idolatrous Egypt, and I brought you out unto myself. Isn't that the same experience we have as we are born again, as we are redeemed, as we are saved, as our sins are washed away, as we are cleansed in the blood of the Lamb? He brings us unto himself. Look at verse 5. In verse 5, now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then it shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. Look at that. All the earth is mine by creation. But if you will obey my voice, as you are redeemed, as you are saved, as I brought you to myself, you will be mine, not by creation only, but by redemption. And therefore, since you will belong to me by creation and by redemption, you'll be above all the other people who only belong to me by creation. And then he tells us in verse 6, he says, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. I want to remind you that that is exactly what the Lord has done for us, children of God. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. In 1 Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 9, it says, but here a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a priesthood of kings, and holy nation, a peculiar people, a peculiar treasure, that he should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You see the similarity between them and us. The past experiences they had and the present experiences we have. We're looking at Psalm 4, reading from verses 3 and 4. In Psalm 4, reading from verse 3, it says, but know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. Remember, the psalmist was talking to the children of Israel, and he said, this you must know, this you must recognize, that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. The Lord will hear when I call unto him. Look at verse 4. In verse 4, it says, standing on and seeing not, stand in awe, wonder as to the goodness of God, as to the grace of God, and stand with amazement, and do not continue in sin, and sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still. Isn't that the same experience we have when you say stand in awe and then do not continue in sin? What he did for them, he has done for us. We're looking at Leviticus chapter 20, reading from verse 7. Leviticus chapter 20, verse 7, sanctify yourselves therefore, and be ye holy, for I am the Lord your God. Verse 8 tells us, and ye shall keep my statutes and do them. I am the Lord which sanctify you. Sanctify yourself. Set yourself apart. Consecrate yourself. I brought you to myself. Commit yourself. Submit yourself. Abandon yourself unto me. And when you totally submit, there's absolute submission. And then there's that surrender. And there's that consecration. I am the Lord which purify you. I am the Lord which sanctify you. I am the Lord that will give you that experience after salvation. That's what he did for them, and that is what he has also done for us. The past experiences of the children of Israel and the present experiences of the people of God. Look at verse 26 there. In verse 26, and ye shall be holy unto me, for I, the Lord, am holy, and have severed you, have separated you from other people, that ye should be mine. You remember 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 17, come out from among them and be ye separate, says the Lord, and I will receive you, and ye shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord Almighty. The same thing he told the children of Israel, I've severed you, I've separated you, I've brought you to myself. The same thing he has done for us. And he wants us to recognize that even though we have all those experiences, don't be ignorant and don't be forgetful of the children of Israel, of what happened to them even after such experiences. We're coming to Matthew chapter 4, reading from verse 4. In Matthew chapter 4, reading from verse 4, you remember, for the children of Israel, the edge of that spiritual meat that the Spirit of God, that God Almighty gave them, and they drank of that spiritual drink out of the rock. Now we also, we have the same experience, and he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That's the bread of life now, and we have that bread of life every time. They are the age, and we have our own as well. And then he said they drank of that spiritual drink out of the rock. In John chapter 4, reading from verse 10, John chapter 4, reading from verse 10, it says, and Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knowest the gift of God, and who it is that says unto thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee the living water. And then in verse 14 it says, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. You remember the water they drank, the bread they ate, and now we have the bread of life, and we have the water of life. And because the experiences they had is the same experiences at a higher level that we have. That's why he's saying, don't forget that. Remember that. Be not ignorant that whatever you have, you Corinthians born again, you Corinthians sanctified, and you Corinthians purged and purified, and you Corinthians filled with the Holy Ghost, and you Corinthians not behind in any of the gifts of the Spirit, you must remember our fathers who went through the wilderness, and then they had similar experiences too. And they had the desire that they will get to heaven. It wasn't only that they came out of Egypt, not only that they came to the land of Canaan. The same way you are eager to get to heaven, you are passionate about getting to heaven, you are prayerful and watchful about getting to heaven, in the same way, all those worthies of old, all those fathers in the faith, in the Old Testament, they were also eager to get to Canaan land, the Canaan of heaven. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 11, reading from verse 14. Hebrews chapter 11, we're reading from verse 14. It tells us what they were eager for. It says, for they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. They seek a country beyond the land of Canaan, beyond the land flowing with milk and honey. They were seeking after a country, and they were pursuing a country. Verse 15, in verse 15 it says, and truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. Look at verse 16, it says, but now They desire a better country. Old Testament people, they desire a better country. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, and all the rest of them, they look beyond the land of Canaan. They look beyond all the earth here. They desire a better country, that is, an heavenly, wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. He has prepared for them a city. That's talking about them, about the children of Israel. And the same thing is said about us. Hebrews chapter 13, we're reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 13, reading from verse 12. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without outside the gate. In verse 13, it says, let us go forth. Therefore, it is referred to the people of the past, that they desired a better country and they wanted to get to heaven. And now he's talking about us, the present day people. Let us go forth, therefore, unto him without the cap, bearing his reproach. Why? Verse 14. In verse 14, for here have we no continuing city, but we seek one to come. The same thing that happened to them, and the same passion they had, the same pursuit they had. They were seeking a better country, the heavenly country. And we too were seeking that same country, the heavenly country, heaven. Now, as you compare the past and the present, the question is it everyone that came out of Egypt that got to the land of promise? You know the answer. The answer is no. Then is it everyone that is born again now, everyone that attends a gospel church, a Bible believing church, everyone that testifies, I'm saved, I'm sanctified, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost, is it everyone that gets to heaven? We wish it will be so. But really, from what we're learning from the word of God, we have a duty, we have a responsibility, and we have the commandment the Lord has given us, that we need to keep ourselves in the love of God and keep ourselves in the way of righteousness, so that we can get there. Well, we'll get there in Jesus' name. Let's come to point number two now. Point number two, preventable self-exclusion. Preventable. There were people in the land of Israel that excluded themselves. Moses did not exclude them. Others did not exclude them by their own choice, by their own fleshly act, by their own corruption, by their own backsliding, by their own unbelief, they excluded themselves. That was preventable. But unfortunately, they excluded themselves permanently from the land of Canaan. They excluded themselves permanently from the heavenly city. Preventable, yet permanent self-exclusion through corruption. We're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we're reading from verse 5. But with many of them, God was not well pleased. He brought them out, but with many of them, God was not well pleased. They ate manna every day for 40 years, and they drank water supernaturally out of the rock. But with many of them, God was not well pleased. They looked at the brazen serpent and they were healed. Everyone that looked on that brazen serpent. And yet it says, but with many of them, God was not well pleased. Those were the people that wanted the gift without commitment, consecration to the giver. Those were the people that wanted the water, but they didn't have respect and honor for the rock from where that water came. Those were the people that took the manna and they took the blessing, but the blesser, the one that blessed them, they didn't have regard for him. But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Look at verse 6. In verse 6, it says, now, the six were our examples, to the intent we should not lust after evil things, as they also lusted. It said the problem wasn't with God. God wanted them in heaven. God wanted them to get to the end of the journey. God wanted them to get to the land of promise, the land of Canaan. But they lusted after evil things. And he's saying that now we should not lust after evil things as they lusted. What does that mean? What did they do? How did they act? What was their composure or their comportment that made God not to be pleased with them? Look at verse 7. In verse 7 it says, neither be ye idolaters. He was now talking to the Corinthians believers. He was talking to the Corinthians brethren. He was talking to the Corinthians members of the family of God, those who were saved at the present time, in the present dispensation, in the present better covenant. Neither be ye idolaters, as some of them, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Now, you might wonder, what if somebody who is a believer, a child of God, who is born again, who has been brought by God unto himself, what if he becomes an idolater? What will happen? What will happen? 1 Corinthians chapter 6, we're reading from verse 9. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, reading from verse 9, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Whether that unrighteous person is somebody claiming and testifying, I'm saved, I'm born again, I'm sanctified, I have the gifts of the Spirit. Know you not, Corinthians, that the unrighteous in Corinth, the unrighteous in Ephesus, the unrighteous in Colossae, the unrighteous anywhere, the unrighteous anytime in any century, know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators nor idolaters. Idolaters. He reminded the people, idolatry, going back to idolatry, is what made some of those people that came out of Egypt not to get to the Canaan land. And then Paul the apostle now says, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. In verse 10, it says, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. It says, as it happened to them, that idolatry prevented them from getting to the land of promise. So today, anyone who claims to be saved, who claims to be sanctified, who claims is on his way to heaven, if he goes into idol worship in any form, he will not inherit the kingdom of God if he dies in that condition. We're back to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and we're now reading from verse 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 8, neither let us commit fornication. It was writing to the Corinthians, the believers, the brethren. It said, whatever the temptation, remember, yielding to that temptation will take heaven from you. yielding to that temptation will drive you, can drive you into hell, not only for 10 years, 100 years, 1,000 years, forever and ever. He said those people in the wilderness that yielded to fornication and adultery, that they perished forever. They didn't get to heaven. They didn't get to the kingdom of God, and they were not there for a short time. And when they got there, they were not burnt up. They remained there. They're still there now, those who got to hell at that time. They're still there because the smoke of their torment will ascend forever and ever. It is an everlasting thing. Hell is everlasting. That place of torment is eternal. That's why he told the believers, and he said, neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and they fell in one day 23,000. Everybody is doing it. That's not an excuse. Everybody is doing it. That does not lessen the punishment, the calamity, the condemnation, and the damnation that comes upon the person. Popular people are doing it, and rich people are doing it. Religious people are doing it. Respected people are doing it. That does not excuse anyone. It says they fell in one day 23,000. Does it still matter today? We know it mattered at their own time, and they perished at their own time. What happens today to the fornicator who dies in fornication, to the adulterer who dies in adultery? In Galatians chapter 5, we're reading from verse 19. I was looking at Galatians chapter 5, verse 19. Now the works of the flesh are manifest now at this time, in this generation, and with this new covenant. We're now outside the old covenant. In this covenant now, the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness. Look at verse 20. In verse 20, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, that is copying other people. All those people, we see them, their stars, their models, and then this is their lifestyle, and some people follow after that. Emulations, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies. In verse 21, envies, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things, whatever their profession, they which do such things, whatever their bold face, they which do such things, whatever their excuse, they which do such things, whatever their popularity, they which do such things, whatever the excuses may be, they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Now you understand, after death, on the other side of the grave, there are only two places, not three: the kingdom of God, heaven, and then the other side, hell. And whoever does not get to heaven gets to the other side, hell, and is forever and ever. That's why the warning is coming to us, and is saying, don't let us behave, don't let us act like those other people acted, and they excluded themselves from heaven, from the land of promise, from the land of Canaan. It says we should abide by the word of God, and then the grace of God that bringeth salvation teach us and lead us and strengthen us to be sober, to be godly, and to remain peculiar unto the Lord, because all those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. We're back to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and we're reading from verse 9 and verse 10. In verse 9, neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and they were destroyed of serpents. It says, you know, there are people that you see, it's like they say they are teasing God, they are testing God. God said, if this happens, it doesn't have any favorite, this is the consequence of what will happen. And then they test God. Will God do what he has said? They behave like little children at home. That is said, don't touch that thing. If you touch that thing, this is what I will do. I will deny you of this and that. And in their mind, they say, Daddy can't do that. Daddy loves me so much. And so they tease Daddy. They don't really want to do evil or do any bad thing. They take it like play. And they take it like, let me tease Daddy. Let me test Daddy. Let me see whether Daddy will do what he said he will do. And then the child does that, and Daddy comes and he says, I will do what I said I will do. Daddy, you know, I'm a child. I was just playing. I was teasing you. Are you not my daddy? Daddy, Daddy, you will not do that. Well, maybe Daddy will not do that, but you cannot do that with God. If you say, well, I'm born again, I'm a child of God, I can resist temptation, I can resist that thing, but I just want to, you know, he's my daddy. And they don't call God our Father who art in heaven. They say, Daddy in heaven, I want to do this now, and I want to test whether you will do this or that. And the word of God says, don't commit sin and say you are testing and you are teasing or you are tempting the Lord. The consequence is terrible. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and they were destroyed of serpents. Then in verse 10 it says, neither murmur ye. Neither murmur ye. There are people, they don't have long suffering. They don't have self-denial. They don't have any perspective of living for the Lord. Any little sin, it's like they think Christianity is a bed of roses. Everything will please me. Everybody will serve me. Everybody will be nice to me. If there is accidental happening that gives them discomfort, even though people do not do it deliberately, if it gives them discomfort at all, and everybody is not, you know, behaving like their slave, behaving like their servant, and then anything rubs them the other side, they are ready to murmur. They are ready to complain. They are ready to do whatever evil may come to their mind. Those ones are not thinking of heaven. Those ones, they hear the word of God and they know that this is the consequence of evil. But when the temptation comes, it's like they have never heard the word of God. It's like they are ignorant of the word of God. And Paul the apostle said, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant, that murmuring and complaining and criticizing and tearing things apart will make the anger of God to come upon such people. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and they were destroyed of the destroyer. I pray we will not be destroyed. I will not be destroyed. I pray the Lord will shield us and protect us from all murmuring, grumbling, complaining in Jesus' name. And let's come to Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1, we're reading from verse 12. In Jude chapter 1, we're reading from verse 12. In Jude chapter 1, verse 12, these are spots in your feast of charity. When they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear, clouds they are without water, carried about of winds, whose fruit withereth, without fruit, twice dead, plucked up by the roots. In verse 13, it says, raging waters, raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame, wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness, how long? Forever. Look at verse 14. And Enoch also, the servant from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints. What's he coming to do? Look at verse 15. In verse 15, to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Verse 16, it says, these are murmurers. These are murmurers. Have you discovered those who have been long in the Christian faith, 30 years, 40 years, more than that, they claim to have been saved, and yet their peculiarity is murmuring. They know so much as to how the church should be, how leadership should be, how they should be. We've been here for more than 30 years, and all they do, they always find fault, not about themselves, but about everyone else. They criticize this and criticize that. They even speak against God, and they murmur, why should this be like that? Why should this be like that? And they carry a murmuring heart, a murmuring spirit all about every day, and it affects their attitude, it affects their action, it affects their disposition, it affects their fellowship and interaction with the rest of us. And yet the word of God says, neither murmur ye as some of them murmured, and they were destroyed of the destroyer. These are murmurers, complainers, and walking after their own lust. Whatever does not please them, they must comment. Whatever does not go their direction, they must comment. Whatever does not align with them, they must act somehow. And they must do something to show everybody, yes, I'm coming to church. This is my church. I will never leave this church, but I'm not happy except everything goes my way. And the Lord says, all they want is for things to go according to their desire, according to their laws. And their mouth speaketh great swelling words. Hear them when they boast. Hear them as if the pillars of the church depends on them. Hear them as if what Jesus said, upon this rock I build my church, and the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. See them as they talk, and they say, that's what Christ said, but left to me alone, if I'm not happy, I can bring the church down. No, you cannot. You just bring damnation upon yourself. It says they speak great swelling words, having made persons in admiration because of advantage. Now, those children of Israel that came out of Egypt, and they did not live the life the Lord expected them to live, and they grumbled, and they murmured, and they complained, and they spoke great swelling words of vanity, like Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. What happened to them? We're coming to Hebrews chapter 3. In Hebrews chapter 3, we're reading from verse 10. Hebrews chapter 3, we're looking at verse 10. It says, wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, they do always err in their heart. They do always go astray in their heart. They do always sin in their hearts. They were not victorious over sin, the sin of the tongue, the sin of evil imagination, the sin of evil thought and the sin of evil behavior, they were not victorious. They didn't have the freedom over sin. Therefore, God says, I was grieved with that generation and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. It says in verse 11, so I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Verse 12, take heed, brethren. Take heed, brethren. You see what has happened to other people. Take heed, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief. An evil heart of not believing the warning of the word of God, not believing the word of God, not believing all the checks and balances given in the word of God. It says, take heed, lest there be in any of you, an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. It says, but this is what you do in verse 13, but exhort one another daily, encourage one another daily, warn one another daily, counsel one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Somebody can become hardened through the deceitfulness of sin, and is murmured over and over, criticized over and over, is corrupted himself, herself over and over, until the conscience is totally silenced and seared, and then is so hardened, even though he will read the Bible, even though he will hear the message of the word of God, but he does not tremble at the word of God, and he does not know that this can happen to him and this can happen to her, because he's hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Look at verse 14. In verse 14, but for we are made partakers of Christ on only one condition, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. Verse 15, while it is said today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart as in the provocation. Verse 16, for some, when they had heard, did provoke, howbeit not all that came out of Egypt by Moses. In verse 17, but with whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? Verse 18, and to whom swear he that they should not enter into his rest, but to them that believed not. He saved them. And after their salvation, instead of continuing to believe, they now believed not. They didn't believe the word of God anymore as they believed originally on the day of their conversion. So in verse 19, so we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Jude chapter 1. Verse 5. In Jude chapter 1, verse 5, here is what the Lord is reminding us of. I will therefore put you in remembrance, though ye once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved, having redeemed, having converted, having delivered, the Lord having saved the people out of the land of Egypt. Afterward, after that salvation, after that redemption, after that deliverance from the land of bondage, afterward, after he had said, when I see the blood, I will pass over you, afterward, destroyed them that believed not. Those were the people that permanently excluded themselves from the land of promise. That was preventable, but unfortunately, that's the way they chose and that's the way they went. But God has given us all this warning so that that will not happen to us, will not happen to me. Wake up, will not happen to me. We're coming to point number three now. Point number three is proper and personal self-examination without conceit, without deceiving ourselves, without covering up, without silencing our conscience, without cajoling ourselves as to everything is all right. I know I'm all right. I know everything is okay. Why don't you examine yourself? What we're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, reading from verse 5, it tells us, does not 2 Corinthians chapter 13, reading from verse 5, examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Examine yourselves, not examining other people, investigating other people, evaluating other people, yourself. Examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates? He said the possibility is there that somebody has backslidden and then becomes a reprobate. A reprobate that is cast away. A reprobate that the Spirit of God does not speak to anymore. Ephraim has chosen to go with idols. Let him alone. He said, examine yourself. That's why we're looking at this now, the proper and the personal self-examination without conceit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, reading from verse 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, reading from verse 11. Now, all these things happened unto them for examples, and they're reaching for our admonition. They're reaching for our instruction. They're reaching for our learning, upon whom the ends of the world are come. There's no doubt in your mind what the apostle is saying by the Spirit of God. Those of us who are living at the end of the age, at the end of the dispensation, at this time, very near the coming of the Lord, these things are reaching for our learning, upon whom the ends of the world are come. And then he tells us in verse 12, he says we shouldn't have self-confidence that can get us into trouble. We shouldn't say, no, it happened to others, it cannot happen to me. He says, wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. Let him that thinketh he standeth, that thinketh he steadfast, that thinketh I'm saved, I'm always saved, let him that thinketh is all right, let him take heed lest he fall. And then in verse 13 says, there has no temptation taking you but such as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you, allow you, permit you to be tempted, tested above that ye are able, but he will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that he may be able to bear it. How do we bear? How do we escape that temptation that comes to all people? One is to take heed to the word of God, not to be so sure about ourselves, not to tempt God, not to test God, not to tease God, and not to think that I can do it, I'm a favorite of the Lord, although other people may do that and fall, I can still find my way through. Take heed lest what happened to other people might happen unto you. Hear the word of God and also watch and pray, lest you fall into temptation. Watch, be very careful, and look at your life in the past. What hindered me in the past? Why am I there at this level? Where I am now? Why have I not moved forward? And what was the stumbling block in my path before? What's the peculiar weakness, besetting sin of my life? Examine yourself and see how to prevent any of those things happening again. Have you backslidden before? Have you gone into something before that is not according to the will of God, and you suffered emotionally, and you suffered spiritually, and you suffered physically, and you suffered professionally, and you suffered in various ways? If you are wise, you say, that's what landed me in trouble before. Because of that, now I am watching. Because of that, now I'm careful. Because of that, now I'm preventing that from happening again. When temptation comes and the devil brings his temptation, you remember how Jesus overcame. He said, it is written. And the word of God says they overcame by the word of their testimony. They took the word of God as their testimony, as their property, as what they relied upon. And it says, by the blood of the Lamb. You depend upon the blood that was shed for you. And then the Lord makes a way of escape that you are able to overcome. You are not overconfident. You are not self-confident. You are looking at the word of God, and you are looking at the will of God, and you know that without Him you are nothing, and without Him you can do nothing. Depending upon Him like that, and being prayerful and trusting Him to keep you standing every time, that's how we stand. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 26. We're looking at verse 12. In Proverbs chapter 26, we're reading from verse 12. Seest thou a man wise in his own conceit? There is more hope of a fool than of him. A man who is wise in his own conceit, who is overconfident, who is just walking anyhow, he does not look at this side, that side. Before he crosses the road, he sees all the cars will stop for him, any danger will stop for him, and he just lives a careless life. He can die before his time. Look at the man that is wise in his own conceit. There is more hope of a fool than for that man. We're told in Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 16. Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 16. Be of the same mind one toward another. Don't be so proud, I'm above other people. Other people may try that, and that may make them fall. Other people may go into that inner place of darkness, and then they fall because of that. Me, I can go anywhere, touch anyone, reach anyone. Me, I'm eternally protected. Be of the same mind. Don't think you're above other people. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Look at this. Be not wise in your own conceit. Be not wise in your own conceit. Walk prayerfully and walk soberly and walk carefully. Look at your life so that by the grace of God, the heaven you have been dreaming about and the heaven you have been pursuing, you don't miss that heaven eventually. We're looking at Romans chapter 11, reading from verse 19. Romans chapter 11, reading from verse 19. Thou will say then, the branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. In verse 20, it says, well, because of unbelief, they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. be not high-minded, but fear. Be not high-minded. I am of deeper life. I am of higher life. I am of the greater life. I am more spiritual, holier than everybody else. I don't have to worry about anything. The grace of God is so great in my life. That's what begins the fall of other people. When they become careless, and when they are not like Paul the Apostle, I keep my body under, I keep my eyes under, I keep my ears under, I keep my mouth under, I keep my tongue under, I keep my every part of my body, the sensitive parts, I keep everyone under, so that after I have preached to others, I do not become a castaway. Be not high-minded, but fear. Look at verse 21. In verse 21, for if God spared not the natural branches, take heed. If God spared not the children of Israel, who later went into unbelief, if God spared not those children of Israel that committed fornication, adultery, that murmured, that grumbled, that tested or tempted the Lord, if God spared them not and they perished in the wilderness, then he said, take heed, lest he also spare not thee. In verse 22, he said, behold therefore the goodness and the severity of God on them which fell, severity, on them which fell into unbelief, on them which fell into sin, on them which fell into carelessness, on them which fell into the works of the flesh, severity. But toward thee goodness, toward thee goodness, if on condition thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou also shalt be cut off. That's why the Lord is warning us. That's why the Lord is reminding us. We need to depend upon the Lord and depend upon the strength of the Lord. In 1 Peter chapter 5, reading from verse 8. 1 Peter chapter 5, reading from verse 8. Be sober. That's the life of the Christian. Not frivolous, not jesting, not careless, not carefree, not here and there, not having I don't care attitude. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a running lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Verse 9, whom resist steadfast in the faith. You must make up your mind. You got saved because you made up your mind. You repented because you made up your mind, because you decided, I'm going to give my heart to the Lord. I'm going to believe the Lord. I'm going to get to heaven. It's a personal decision. Now, as you're already born again, and you're on your way to life everlasting, to eternity, to heaven, you must still have that personal decision that I am going to make it to heaven, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Make up your mind, you will stand, and God will help you to stand in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 4. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, we're reading from verse 15. 1 Timothy chapter 4 from verse 15, meditate on these things. All that we have heard, meditate on them. As you get back home, meditate on everything we have heard. Read that passage again, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, from verse 1, all through slowly, and all to verse 13, and think about everything, recollect everything you have heard, meditate upon these things, apply them to your life. And then say, if the Lord will come tonight, where would I be? Meditate upon this, is give thyself wholly to them. Don't be forgetful. Give yourself wholly unto them, that thy profiting may appear unto all. All the people that know you, they will know that your life is now at a higher level. You are getting ready for the coming of the Lord, and your profiting in the word of God is appearing, is visible for everyone to see. In verse 16, it says, take heed unto thyself. Take heed unto thyself. It's good to watch over other people. It's good to help other people, to protect other people. But you are the number one person you should watch over. You see all those other people you are watching over, and the final decision is still in their hands. They can accept your counsel. They can accept your watching over them, or they may not accept. They may accept it while you are there with them. They may not accept it after you have gone. But you are the principal person you are to watch over, and you are to take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine, unto the teaching that you are hearing, that is able to make you wise unto salvation, and to get you sanctified, and to get you holy, and to get you ready and prepared for heaven. You take heed unto all that teaching, for in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. Save thyself. If you are not saved, you cannot get other people saved. If you are not standing, you cannot get other people to stand. If you are not firm and courageous and you are on your way to heaven, if it's not happening to you, you cannot make it happen to any other person. It is who you are, you will reproduce in other people. If you are not a conqueror, you cannot help other people to conquer. If you are trying to touch their lives, teaching them, instructing them, helping them, you are wasting your life and you are wasting their time. You must keep yourself, and you must be standing before you can have the grace, and you can have the liberty, and you can have the right to make other people stand. So take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. I pray the word of God will work effectively, effectually in every one of us, in Jesus' name. A good amen. Amen. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer, and take what we have heard, what we have learned, the admonition to the Lord in prayer. Don't throw the message to other people. This is you now. You want to make sure that you are ready for the coming of the Lord. Rise up and say, Lord, here am I, here am I, here am I. I will allow the word of God to have impact, effect upon my life. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer.